Read the biography in the book. However, that's the thing I would like to say that after that course. I tell you that are very motivated. And you, they are just like you. They are well educated, but they want to do something with their community. They want to give back something, and they do. Great pleasure and love you. So please join me in welcoming my show.
I wanted to own an ice cream truck. we look up to, right?
Yeah.
Every time, every all day, like, we like, nice to meet you.
You're right.
Yeah, we're trying to look up. Sure.
Not
the community, families, say family, who you talk about in your life? Do you like your family?
Yeah.
The parents and stuff?
The parents,
yes.
Right. Okay.
So, parallel family.
Parallel family. Right.
Okay. Anything else?
Oh, we're going to move on.
So,
okay, basically, you know, they talked a lot of the points.
So, we also wanted to focus on, like, I guess, the demographic of the specific community in Orleans, the East Side community. There are over 5,000 Vietnamese Americans there. Pre-Katrina, it's just a population of Vietnamese Americans outside of Vietnam. And this is all within, like, a 1 mile radius, it's like 5,000 Vietnamese Americans. So, for me, like, being, like, an outsider and coming in, like, I've been in Orleans for 2 months, I was like, whoa, I feel like I am seriously in Vietnam. Like,
yeah.
Like, you can go, like, a week without seeing, or with only seeing Vietnamese people, easily. I was talking to Megan, when was the last time I saw someone with Vietnamese?
Yeah,
I think I was at a meeting, because we invited them in.
Yeah.
So,
well, one thing that someone told me over yesterday, during the call, she was like, I couldn't distinguish if it was like Vietnam or New Orleans. So if you're all New Orleans. All this picture you saw was all New Orleans. Alright? It's like all Kitchup or the whole White Center. That's New Orleans. That's our business area. McGee, along the canals, how they have the terrace garden. That's like a grandpa's place, man. Like we have all of that. And it's a Vietnam outside of Vietnam. So it's still in the post-Vietnam War stage, because after the 1975, they settled in New Orleans. They were placed there. They didn't choose to be there. So I guess the government was like, where we need to put these people, where we're gonna put them. So they put them to us as far as possible. So we're 15 miles away from the central of New Orleans, away from my grandpa. So you do have to drive pretty far to get to our meeting. So
to focus it a little more though, when we were talking about the building, that's just like a demographic of people that the people there, since they were mostly fishermen back in Vietnam, when they came to Louisiana, that's what they continued to do. You know how many people like y'all want to own their own businesses, right? So there's a lot of small business owners, grocery stores. There's like this district in the area, which is within that 1 mile radius, so a lot of people own those businesses. So I guess just to kind of understand where it's like, it's really self-sufficient, where like the money that the people earn goes into those businesses, which in turn goes back to the community. So just to let people know. And then like even now, later on, there are also a lot of people are like nail salon owners, and that's pretty common. But I mean, that's pretty much what these youth have to look up to. Like that's the type of work. It's, very hardworking, which is very admirable, honestly. But it's like, when you all are like, yeah, what did I want to be as a kid? You know, like those
weren't
even like visions or
ideas for the
youth.
Another thing that I want to talk about was, it's that type of atmosphere. So like I did a survey, this is like not even small, but I surveyed pre-Katrina. I asked a group of 60 kids who were planning to go to college. Only one of them was saying, it's like, oh shit, what's going on, And I said, so I'm going to college, I don't need to. My parents have a store. I'm going to run my parents' store. I'm going to own that place. That's their mentality. Or my dad owned a shopping boat, And we make a lot of money. Look at my parents. We have a big house. We got Mercedes, That's what they look up to, see? And that's a big problem. We're so isolated. We don't have that type of vision that we do here. And I was just trying to explain it to you yesterday. So
these youth now, with their parents working and also having to go and rebuild their homes after, so they're spending like 10 hours at the store, come home and then they're putting up a sheetrock or painting the house. So there's like no time to really take care of the kids. So they're basically overlooked and neglected. So what we were trying to figure out is like, where are the youth and what are they doing now?
Just remember that they're trying to work to make money to support the family, to put food on the table, yet trying to rebuild their business. And fix the house at the same time. When we say she lost, I need to make sure. She lost the best. Okay, that she lost.
Basically, anything that touched water, anything that's like all the houses, you have to take out everything. You take out the walls, you take out the insulation, and all you have is the living. And then people.
So y'all kind of understand where we're coming from. A lot of people could relate because they didn't understand, but this is when we lost everything. You're coming back, it's like coming from Vietnam to New Orleans. Okay,
So just remember that you're in that safe right now. So where are the youth, you know? What do you think they're doing right now? The parents are like working so hard. What are they doing? Keep in mind, there's no schools. There's no programs. The schools are not even touched yet. Today is actually the day, first day that my organization and New Orleans are cleaning the schools that is coming to. There's nothing to do because all the playgrounds or the grass are day high. The government's not going to. The youth are not being implemented in the plan or not even in the plan. So just think, like, what do you think? Like, what are they doing with that? So.
I have a question. Why aren't the government helping now? Like,
they're
social workers and stuff like that.
See,
right?
That's a problem. We don't have enough social workers in Louisiana. That's on the government side. And if we do have some social workers, we don't have any Vietnamese social workers that understands outcomes, our needs.
Why
don't
you get Vietnamese
social workers? No, I'm just the example because we're so isolated that we're not even, like I said, we're not even in the plan.
I mean, I actually, like, you know, your parents, who would they rather be talking to if someone understands, like, the language and can help them, like, translate? Or is it someone who's just like, this is what you should do, but your parents can't understand it? You know, so it's the same thing, and, like, that's the language, but when you look at this community, it's even more so culture. It's because it's so isolated, that culture, like, that was brought here in 75 is still there. That, like, level of, like, respect for your elders, which, I mean, for me, at least, like, I born here and grew up here, and my parents, they've been here, but it's, like, also, like, being exposed and being able to travel and being able to do things, right? So it's kind of, like, it's really hard still. I know we all deal with, like, the generation gap, but, like, you can kind of try to make them understand. It's just a little bit. But, like, speaking of, like, they've been stuck in the same community with the same people for 30 years, that exposure is still there.
So. Do you have a question?
Well, my question is, so the help that is part of this town specifically, is that going to be a manpower kind of help, or is it going to be more of a role model and presence kind of help?
That's the second one. That's good. Yeah. You mentioned that. That's actually what we want, the second one, the role model. The people who could guide us in the right direction to create a for these youth, say that, you know, I could be better, I could go to school, I'd be whoever I want to be, you know. I mean, that's, we don't need manpower right now. The city is concentrating on rebuilding houses, rebuilding businesses, but the thing is, they're leaving a big portion, which is rebuilding lives. And then that's where I'm here to ask y'all to help us in that process of rebuilding lives, rebuilding the youth. We are focusing on the Vietnamese American community because that's what we lack the most. To answer the audience to your question.
Mm-hmm. So, you kind of just brought that up. What do you all think you can do? I mean, just given, like, now that you know the situation, what's going on? You
have
to think what you can do.
Just imagine if you were that mother kid, you know, that was sitting at home, like, man, I'm not allowed to get you, and there's no school, and the whole community is, like, not doing anything. So you just sit at home playing Counter-Strike, you know, or on MySpace, like, looking at everybody's hang up, you know, that's what we do. that's what we do. You know, we watch every TV show, the CSI, and all that. But, I mean, do you really think that's all they have? I mean, can we offer them something else? You know, can you offer them something else? You know, from a remote location? You can do a lot of things from your community. I mean, just thinking about that, spread awareness to your organization, to your local community, that, you know, we can offer these people, you know? I guess that's we really want you to understand, like, where these youth are standing. You know? So the life of the youth in the site, Katrina. So these are, like, the background. That's a lack of guidance. You already talked a lot about that. There's a lack of guidance. That's a lack of role models. Lack of exposure. And you understand why there's a lack of exposure. It's because we're, like, outside of the community. That's opportunity and have nothing else but opportunity to look into, you know, and lack of opportunities. Like I said already, boat people, nail salon, you know, grocery stores, that's the opportunity that we see as we grow up. lack of voice. You do not have a voice. You know, right now, Vela is the group that I'm in. We're trying to create that voice. Create voice, and man, we need to concentrate on us, because if it's not for us, who's going to take care of the community later on? Who's gonna run this community? Who's gonna run the business? That's where my always trying to tell you about. That's very important. And you can create like a better business. If you educate these youth, you give them type of skills, type of knowledge, and it would make the community progress and get even to create voice on a national level, which I do actually help us in the process. For education, we have one of the worst education system in New Orleans, and family kind of hit that point where we are trying to reform the education system. No more reason to go to school, like I say, there's no education at all. The group that I worked with in last Katrina was at-risk kids. I was just a college student, yet I see these kids like dropping out of school at the age of 12, 13, 14, 15. Why? Because their parents be loud. They can't even have, they don't even have time to like the kids. So that's where we started. And we try to help these kids. And our organization got 30 kids to go back to school. These are like middle and high schools, Because there's no motivation. We had to create that type of motivation. That vision that you can do whatever you want, and we will support you. Lots of gang activity. That's a tremendous gang activity. You start at a young age, and why do gangs start? It's because they want to belong to somebody. They want to belong. They want to have some type of attention. And your friends will give you that attention, right? And when you have no program, what do you do? What do you think of? Just think of whatever. Let's go rob house. Let's go do this. Let's go try new stuff. Let's drink. Let's start doing drugs. I'm not gonna lie. We do all that. And that's not what we want to do. We don't want to promote that. We can prevent that from happening if we do put some youth programs in there and start some activities and expose to drugs, gambling. Just man, they gamble football. Football season comes up, man. All these kids are like gambling big time. It's easy. I don't know y'all gamble. $20, man. You can win like $130 if you pick the right teams, right? You get 120, then you bet again with that 120, you can make like 700. And these kids are like, they start at a young age. And you know why? Because their parents gamble too. See, so that's another thing. They still look up to their parents, and that's all they know, and that's what they're doing.
So, just in terms of grading season, coming from California, I'm like, hurricane, but like, we don't ever have sports kind of stuff, right? BC, I'm like, okay, snowstorm, got that, but hurricane, what is that? But it rains really hard, and I'm like, oh my gosh, rain, thunder, lightning.
You know, that is soft, I'm like, wow, it's a lightning, I'm saying,
good. You're in for a treat, not like 2 weeks ago.
I'm like, man, you've never seen a lightning before. So.
It is pretty cool. But anyways, so, I guess, to go to hurricane industry, it'll lead up to crazy camp. Basically, July 5th, tropical storm city. If you look at these dates, it's like 1 week after the next. Like, tropical storm city hit, and it like devastated the city. Like, we did not think that our thing was going to be that bad. So there was no time to recover. People didn't have time to fix up like what has already been damaged. So then, it's not just a hurricane that's in the city. It's like it's already damaged, and then none of us can get. So then, when Hurricane Jess came along a week later, people evacuated because what they saw in the tropical storm city. So they were like, okay, we gotta get out. But then,
So you see coming in. So.
Yeah, but then it missed, right? Yeah. It kind of like
sort of low.
Yeah, so false alarm, number one. And then the following week, Hurricane Katrina was blocked. They're like, oh no, another hurricane. So it's like everyone evacuated again. And then that one hit.
Let me tell you a little bit about the hurricane when you evacuate.
Yeah.
Alright, to me it's a vacation, alright? Every time I guess we have a school religion, the thing is it costs money, right? You're driving like 10 hours to get some place that takes you only an hour. You stay in the car by yourself, sending your life out. You have to pack everything, notebook, whatever you have. It costs a lot of money. That's what I just want to tell you. It costs a lot of money because you have to rent, you have to book a hotel, you drive for it, buy food because you don't have no kitchen. So it costs roughly, if you have a small family, it costs you $300 to $400 to evacuate and be helpful. Alright? So think about it. You're not working because you're evacuating. And you have to be at ice. Then like two weeks, you know, you have to go there. So, you know,
and then a month later, you know, Hurricane Katrina comes on. You know, people are like, man, we have two false alarms. You know, at the end of the month, paychecks are coming in. People, you know, they need to get their paychecks in order to, you know, survive. You know, people who live with paycheck to paycheck. So, after what happened, it is like an easy week. You know, so it's not like people aren't prepared. That's why not. It's just like in the situation. It's like, you know, you've already been through two false alarms, right? Like, is that $600? And then your paycheck's coming in, like,
you're going to go. Your mentality is like, man, it's my turn. It's my turn. You know, it's my turn. Right? I didn't leave until Sunday. I was right out my money, my phone calls, and you better leave, man. You have to stay in my house. You know, so I left just to make them happy. You know, I grabbed two t-shirts, flip-flops, my two shorts, my gel, and
essentials.
Yeah, I didn't need it. So, it's kind of bad. I'm not going to have to pay more for 10 hours. I have more TVs, you know. So,
it's great mix.
Yeah, my audience, DJ. So yeah, that's what we have to go through every year. Right, so this Katrina thing, when you see on TV, man, it's like, you have to understand where we're coming from too. Why are we not waiting? That's why we're here to tell you. A lot of people were affected. Remember why I just said, I got two t-shirts, two shorts, and blah, 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 blah. Everything else was lost. I'll tell you, that was my first year of tomorrow, too. All of everything, you know. My mom lost her wedding ring, and everything's so sad, but I don't even know what it's like. We can talk later about that.
And then this follow up with like the average of going on Hurricane a month later.
We went for 3 weeks without electricity, without cold showers. And gas, oh my god, you have to like wake up, stay in too long, you stay in long gas, and like spend 3 hours waiting to gas. And we try not to go anywhere, because we don't know yet.
You said you're from Orlando, so Tallahassee. And were you affected or had you evacuate or anything?
Well, I grew up in Texas. My family grew up in Ohio. Depending on, I don't think you had any right back, but yeah, it's last year.
But then have you evacuated a lot of people?
Most of their homes, I don't think residents are evacuated most times. So the trailer parks have evacuated mobile homes. Mm-hmm. Not the house, because they're typically very difficult. And scaling, so you don't have the short break.
This place where I have to go to Houston, Texas, Dallas, Austin, Orange County, mostly Orange County. So, then what happens? They experience culture shock. You know, we've been in this isolated community. You see white people. That's serious. Seriously, they don't know how to react. But my brother, of course, it was Latinos. He didn't know how to react. So, he didn't know how to communicate with these things. He went to Saddleback, and he was there for 2 or 3 weeks till he dropped out. Like probably 4 months before he dropped out of school. And so it's that serious. Like it's a lot of mental problems that happen. But you at that age, you don't have your friends, right? You're back here like 1,500 miles away. And you need to deal with this, you know. You don't know how to react to these kids, and nothing is the good news is that it's like, we want to be friends. You know, like, you can make them know, we have to. Other people are suffering. It's actually in here somewhere. But this is what I'm talking about. Like, this guy, Steven, we talked to him like right before we came in. He's like, man, I went to school with white people before. You know, it's like it's a different environment. There's a different education system there. We have to do with that. We're perceived as closed-minded, isolated. But the thing is, whatever we know, it's right to us. And whatever they know, it's right to them. So they think we're closed-minded. People were not used to the same hospitality idea. You know, in New Orleans, like I say, like you should do really well. You supply, you don't pay for anything. You gas, you pay for everything. And that's how we learn. This is like planet over time. So you go to the top, you know, show you around. You know, that's how it is there. And you know, if you go to like Houston or not, they're not Houston, but like California, Texas, like you expect that too, you know. The thing is, we don't get that. You know, like, yes, because it doesn't mean, man. We actually do both, like, yeah, well, you know, we'll do. So that's an issue about with that. Culture class between New Orleans culture and Moonrise. Just New Orleans itself, we have our own culture already. Being Vietnamese and from New Orleans, and it's like, oh, man. So, it's my question, like, a little bit 16, by the way. And, you know, he was very impressed out, you know, very impressed. I can't go to school, you know, and it was really bad. New Orleans, we're not wrong. And like I said, people are like, you know, why do we have to cater to you? You know, why are the people here? And we're used to what we have. So we want to, you know, they were just rude to others.
So there are lots of things, Rob. You should have to, like, even more so, there's like kind of thing was saying, you know, that's guilty depression or like feeling like you dropped out of school, it's like what do you mean now? So it's like those like things happen and then that made things worse.
But it's the same thing. So they're like slowly depressing it. Still drugs, all that. Well, not a little bit more responsible. And all the guys like still trying to struggle with it. My life. So this is the first thing that we have. Masa and Mela. So we have a Mela photo down another place called Viet, the Asian Society Pass, this Asian American Students Association, American Vietnam. So the Lao is a radio station on a national level. So this is the only resource we have on a national level. Is the Masa. So that's why we're here today, thanks for national help.
So we don't know like what we have.
So, thanks for your questions over there. We have a lot of people, a lot of manpower already. So
in terms of building these things here and what we want to do, yes, I know everyone asks, so what can we do?
This is where you wake up.
So,
we're just trying to get information so you have like, what are we working for? You know, who are we trying to help? So.
Basically, what we want to do is empower them, you know, give them that exposure, give them that vision. You know, I can do this, or you know, I have skills to do something better than advising them. So what we are proposing in particular is to bring your skills, your knowledge, exposure that we have here and bring it to you. For instance, a conference, yes, that's kind of a big, like, you know, idea. Like, I mean, ideally, that's what we'd like to have. We have a conference like this so that you can come out, you build leadership, you can expose them to entertainers, you know, have them meet people, people models, listen to speakers. But to an Estonian talent, what we want to do is have like a 1 year, I guess, commitment kind of deal, and then do 4 events within that year. So it'd be like every 3 months, there'd be something that would focus on developing skills for you and empowering other people for them to do something like that.
And so they'll all actually work together into one goal, something that they already have. Like an example, entertainment, right? We want to, first of all, like, concentrate on like bringing in like, awesome sports entertainment. Such as what do we have?
We had let's see, like one would be But so one is entertainment in terms of maybe someone who plays a guitar, something that can catch their attention. Like some like mainstream music but like have to be like a Vietnamese American artist. And then after that person can inspire them to so maybe go into like the music profession. Do something out of the ordinary besides like working with their parents. And so that would be kind of a one-day thing, kind of come in, play, catch your attention, and then do a work afterwards and talk to them and inspire you.
So trying to find a way to kind of draw these youth in to this type of like program, show them like, man, you're fun, you can do a lot of we're doing this new. And in fact, as a new NASA, we're using options that we already have, bringing our resources, organize our the kinds of programs that we already have, the stuff that you already do in your organization, and just pretty much, just outsourcing it to us to do and make a difference on this youth.
So that's one example. And we kind of want to do like an art series, like art performance, art creative art, different forms of art. So the next one would have been like, be like spoken word, that person come in, perform, and then our main have like a singer, and after that do a creative writing workshop. So you're giving them like writing skills, but animation, writing skills teach you. So far, I mean, yes, great for everything, an essay for everything, right? And so that's what I think. And then one more was like, are you answering the party? Because we also want them to be able to document their experiences. Because it's like, have you heard like the experience of Hurricane Katrina from a youth perspective? You know, it's always gone the other way. And it's like, they're the ones that will tell you the most unique and most like, truthful like, story. It's not kids.
We have none. If you want to look, really have to find it, you have to go to eBay up to 5 6 because it's not being exposed. It's not a big need in new ones because you know, we never had the new ones. We didn't. So they're like donating us please get to this youth to like read up and like understand like, wow, it's more than just New Orleans. Right? Spread the awareness. Instead of buying a plane ticket, you know, if you can't go or whatever, you use that money to start some other projects, you know, meet up with that. You know? Plus some projects that we were talking about earlier. Whatever skills you think that you could offer, write it out, you know, or try to do something or maybe
you can write out, plan it, send it to us, and we'll work with you to see what you can do. And then, you know, and then as this is our shameless plug, this is what I do, I work for UNAVSA, but I know a lot of people want to come down and they're like, oh yeah, you know, maybe we can mention the youth for a week. But the problem with that is that, okay, so you come in, you talk to youth, you get to know them, you become their friend, and you leave. So that doesn't really give them like a mentor, it doesn't give them a role model. I mean, that's something that I deal with like every single day, so it's like, for like the first time, like, month when I'm there, it's more like sit back and just absorb everything and understand what's going on with the community. I still like to do it every day. So I'm seeing how like a lot of people want to do that because they want to actually go in and like, you know, work with them, but you can also see how it can be more harmful to the community. So we're saying that you are gonna like, you know, invest time and it has to be a long period of time. And specifically with the Zenfin Fellowship, it's either quarterly, half time or full time. I'm with one there for a year. Just are attending 4 months at a time and fellows like this.
You make money too, so you're making money to something that you know you might have a passion for. So it's you know, just a win-win situation. And how can your party offer? So it's about you know, so we can spend big the organization of the fundraising to send you know, and to expose this to you know. I'm always inspired by Malfi, but I'm traveling to see this guy. You know, if you could bring him to New Orleans. That's a whole different story. You impact all these kids and you know, all these youth. Where it was to, maybe they would fight themselves instead of going to others. Yes, it's tears. Another thing is, you know, organized conferences and type of thing. Yeah.
And then, I guess, instead of maybe, since you don't talk about exposure, right? We do want to use that, but a great way is also to send to women. You know, like he has like that, to be able to go out and go to these models and then bring that model back and do some of that. So, our idea is also sponsoring. So, instead of that $40 plane ticket, you would just go down there and then you know, it's going to happen, right? Instead of you know, sponsor that, you can go out to conference.
Yeah, go to whatever conference you want to organize.
It's like last week, didn't you make a high school conference?
Yeah, I heard a conference from
SoCal.
Yeah, I heard SoCal. Texas have a youth conference they put together too. So maybe y'all can put like you sponsor these youth, like 5 students or whatever to fly to Texas and you get to interact with these kids and show them to inspire them and like really like make a difference, make an impact. You see it. I promise you that. And this is the last slide, right? So what I'm gonna tell y'all is okay. Whatever y'all do, y'all going to an area where it's untouched, it's never been touched before. So whatever y'all bring to the community, you can see the difference. You see that something's going to change, some type of impact. You will see this on the media. Media is something that we've been sharing on a lot. So this is for example, we came in and taught or organized something for a school of arts, right? Came and they saw this type of work, saw doing spoken words, right? They're going to start doing that, then maybe they're going to get at it. Or we're going to run with it, or stop it. They start having more video, and they can send the video to you, show them, hey, you know, thank you for teaching me this. Or maybe you can give me the opportunity to learn how to you know, do a film or whatever. I mean, you see a lot of things like education skills that you can offer to these youth, you will see a difference because they have nothing to have. It's like a great opportunity to make a difference because like, that's not the need for something to do. So we have to open up to any questions.
You have a, what do you call it? A
Zenfin
Fellow?
Yeah, it's an application process. It's a program through UNAVSA. It's called collaboration community building. So this event is called Darling Place throughout the U.S. and New York City, Seattle, Houston, there's some San Diego, in California, and New Orleans, Biloxi. But this is a year of recognizing the need to, you know, assist in development, particularly in the community, about all the different calls that are in New Orleans. So there's four that are full-time there. I can imagine that's more financial issue, that this is a decision to develop in. And then another thing is the end of the day that they want to be in terms of the community. So, I mean, each of us have different roles.
Maybe talk to Mai afterwards.
Is there, like, is there a website for their role?
You said these are all things that we ask people to do for long, but how did you get these lists of stuff? Is it something we had to do talking to do or something in the small group testing?
We did our research assessment on the and did the things of the told you what the conference is, like a big deal. We know the conference is one before, just to let them know that. Just going on many youth conferences, which are a lot of stuff. So we don't have, we thought you all have youth conferences or organized conferences, or just do some type of funding.
I
want to know, aside from the side, is there any other music pieces in the music itself that are going to be interested in? Like the whole museum, the music piece, in the museum. The thing is, again, we need some money to train these people to have a leadership role, to give them a reason why they should interact with these youth. A lot of people have years in the past to read how to change to have impact, you know. They don't have that. So that's why we're asking you to help us in the process of rebuilding and building a future for these
youth. You all have heard the example and resource and you as an organization as individuals, so I hope that you'll be able to do that and find out information putting in mind.
To organization to go back to your community, your community, show these district where this is the first your community, right, in community. So, we kind of this to you.
Thank you.